This is Hacking the Afterlife Podcast with Jennifer Shaffer.
Hello, Jennifer.
Hi, Richard.
Boy, do you look lovely today.
Thank you.
Well, you look lovely every day, but you know.
No, it's, I have had this dress for, it's literally rainbow, like rainbow. I've had it for 3 months and I decided to wear it today. And my first client ended up telling me at the end, she goes, I asked for one sign before I came here. And it was, I asked for a rainbow from my grandfather.
Wow.
And you walked up.
You're wearing a rainbow.
Wearing a rainbow. That was a sign. She goes, absolutely. That was the only sign I asked for.
That's so adorable and lovely. How was your Halloween, dear? Day of the Dead, Day of the Jennifer.
The Day of the Dead. So Monday night I had an event.
Yeah.
Excuse me for 1 second. Let me put this on. Can you
bleep the bleeping? For those driving in their car, that little sound was Jennifer's computer talking to her.
Yeah, I thought I had all my notifications off. I had an event Monday night at my girlfriend Jessica Alba's house. And it was a beautiful, every year she does something to celebrate the Day of the Dead. And so this year we did it on the 1st, and she has the most magnificent altar. I posted the altar, a video of it this morning.
Wow.
It just, she had all of the rest of, like all the food of all of her relatives. There was 20 of us. And then each person went around the table and gave a memory, their favorite memory of somebody that has passed. And it was just beautiful. And so each one of us did that. And then we went into a different room and I read everyone. We drew names out of a hat.
Oh my gosh, that's so cool.
It was really cool. And then Halloween, I spent it with some friends. I was really tired on Halloween.
I would think so.
And then last night we had a sold out at Uncorked in Manhattan Beach. So I read 22 people last night. I have an event tonight. Tomorrow I get to read all of the Los Angeles Kings, their wives.
What? That's great. How cool is that?
Yeah, so that should be fun. It's just nonstop. And then I have a poker tournament for a charity benefit.
You know, whatever you do, don't play poker with a medium because, you know, they can read your cards. They're right over your shoulder. What the heck?
We're going to see how it works.
Very good. Well, that's exciting. You've been doing so much. That's so cool. And I'm, you know, people reaching out and talking to loved ones. That's such a lovely idea to do a Day of the Dead about loved ones, you know, and to have a memory about them and talk about them. It literally brings them into the room.
It was so, my heart was so full when I was there. And I've been doing it every year for like the last 5 years at our house. You know, and
yeah.
It truly is such a gift for me to see because I work with the dead, but I didn't, and I try to honor my dad and I try to honor my loved ones, but I never thought of it like that. You know, it was interesting.
Well, it is interesting also because the more you talk to people on the flip side, the more you realize they are not dead. That, you know, that process of going off stage, just one of many times they've done that. They've gone off stage many times. We've all done it before. It's a remembering because we always ask people when they get to the flip side, who was there to greet you? And it's like, they're not surprised by the question.
Right.
You know, it's something that, well, speaking of the not so very dead, our friend Luana, who is our moderator of our class on the flip side, does she have anybody she wants to talk to or about?
There's already somebody here, but hold on. So again, not trying to judge it. Let me explain something. So Santa Ynez, I had an event on Saturday night.
Uh-huh.
That day I was coming home and Matthew Perry died that night.
Mm-hmm.
That day I was coming home, Freddie and I were, because I had to work. I had clients all day. And I got Matthew Perry and I got the chills. And I'm like, wait a second. And he's like, I'll see you later. And I thought, okay, whatever that meant. And then my first client actually knew him.
Oh, wow.
I knew him. And I'm like, how could this happen so quickly, right? And then the next day on Halloween, I'm talking to my clients whose son passed away. And Matthew shows up again. I'm like, did you know Matthew? She goes, no, but my son who's over there did. He went and got him. He goes, I have Matthew. I'm like, what? She goes, yeah, they worked on a couple of TV shows together.
So Matthew showed up.
He showed up again. You know, he actually worked with the person that passed away. They both worked on a show together on a couple episodes. And so I'm like, okay, I'm not judging it. And then I was somewhere yesterday where I had an appointment and he shows up again. And I'm like, okay, this is just work. Why are you showing up again? And he goes, talk to her. Tell her that you just talked to me. And so I told the person that was in front of me and she goes, oh, you know, Annette, like Inez Kopitar, who is a client of mine, Chandler, Matthew Perry, he was actually at their wedding 10 years ago.
Wow.
She owned the place that we were at, that I was at. And so I'm like, this is just, you know, and so then today, all of a sudden we're just about ready to go and he shows up again. And I'm like, Luana, is he allowed? Does he just get a,
does he get a free pass? Well, let's ask Lou. Let's ask Luana what that's about.
Yes. But what's interesting though, I have lots of questions too, is the fact that, okay, show me again. Hold on. Okay. It goes back to not judging it. You know, we've talked about this, right? And when new people go, you know, newly people that go over there, they don't have boundaries. So they just come in whenever they want. But he had some really important things to say to this other couple yesterday that I related a message to. And they're like, oh, they couldn't, you know, they were so grateful because they knew him so well. So yes, he is here. So you go ahead and ask the question since.
All right. Well, first I want to ask Luana, what's that about? I mean, was he standing by to come and talk to us or why does he want to talk to us today?
He likes what we're doing. He has a lot of friends that I'm probably going to end up talking to. And he just wanted me to get, that's so funny. Thank you. He just wanted me to get used to it.
Well, what can I say other than we're honored for you to show up and talk to us? So yeah. What do you want to say? You know, I'm going to ask you the same questions I ask everybody. So who was there to greet you when you crossed over?
He said he has a lot of people over there. People that I wouldn't necessarily know, but people that along his journey, they lost their life to addiction. And I know he just went like this with his book. He goes, well, if you would have read my book, you'd have all that information.
Yes, you did. You wrote a book about your life and your journey. I happened to see a little bit of it the other day.
The one thing he does want people to know is that, okay, you tell me. Hold on. He didn't have any drugs or alcohol. He worked out or did something and he was detoxing from, like, you know, how when you sweat too much or whatever,
yeah.
It dealt with his heart. I felt like he had an aneurysm or he had a heart attack before.
So Matthew, do you want to show Jennifer what you were doing just prior? What was the exercise and
pickleball? He showed me pickleball.
That, did you not know that, Jennifer?
No.
No. Okay. So that is his partner who we played pickleball with. Came out and said that they spent, like, you know, whatever they did, like an hour of game or whatever amount of time you play pickleball for. And he was like, you know, coming down from that. So you're absolutely right. So, but Matthew, so was it your heart give out? Was it a heart attack or what was that about?
Couldn't go to sleep. He wanted to go to sleep and he couldn't go to sleep. So he went in the jacuzzi and he said that it was just, you know, a little bit of dehydration, a little bit of working because of working out.
Yeah, I understand. All right, let me go back to the question about who greeted you. I know that you had a close friend who was an actor who passed away. And I just want to ask about him. Yes, that is his name. And that is who I was thinking of. Yeah, I was just going to ask. So have you had a chance to talk? Go ahead, Jennifer. I'm interrupting.
No. He showed me, he's like River Phoenix. He's a great communicator, which I do love about. Okay, because he wanted to call him Chandler. But he just said, he goes, River Phoenix. I'm like, I and I don't know how they, but yeah.
Well, I was okay. Well, let me ask you.
He said that they laughed hysterically, like, what the fuck? Like, out of all the times he could have died, right? He dies this way. He's like, it was embarrassing. He goes, I would have at least, like, maybe, you know, he's showing me next to James Dean, like being on a Harley. Like, that would have been a cool way to go, you know?
He was in a Porsche. But whatever. Yeah, no, I get it. Whatever. Yeah, more dramatic. But let's ask you about that. So what was that like when you saw River, your friend, your pal?
Love. He said absolute love and laughter.
And Matthew, would you do me a favor just because we can? Can you bring River forward?
He's like, I have to go get him. Okay. I don't know who River Phoenix is. I feel like he's here.
That's fine. River, you're probably not familiar with what we're doing, or maybe you are, but we talk to people on the other side. We try not to be invasive any way, but we like to talk to people about their journey or what it was like. I know you were friends with Matthew. I know that you guys did a movie together at the start of your career. And I know that he was devastated by the loss. Have you been to visit him while he was still on the planet? Did you come and visit? Go ahead, Jennifer.
What does he want to say? He showed me the other guy too that greeted him was the guy that the comedian, the guy that
Gary Shandling.
Yeah.
The golfer.
Yeah, I don't know.
So River's showing you Gary Shandling as somebody who greeted him or was hanging out with him?
No. So the guy that played golf, the one that we talked to that passed over, that said, yeah.
What was that like? Was that amusing or?
You just said, dude, it could have been worse.
Let me ask you, River, because I can. Who greeted you when you crossed over?
Felt like his grandparents.
Okay.
Yeah. He also had a friend that died like right around the same time. I'm not sure. I don't know. I'm not sure.
So let me ask you a simple question in terms of your brother who is on the planet. I met him at one point and is an actor, a very terrific actor. What's your observation about your brother? I mean, you have a sister and I always knew he'd do it.
I always knew he'd do it. He didn't know.
Do you work with him?
He had a lot to live up to. He said, he's laughing about it with him, but he always knew that he would do it. He'd be big.
So if you can,
when he was alive.
Since you've been on the flip side, have you been able to show up to him in dreams or is he aware of your presence or is he not?
No, he's aware. He's definitely aware.
Okay. And generally, when do you show up to see somebody? Are they stressed or when they're sleeping or what?
He showed me Jim Carrey channeling. You know how Jim Carrey channeled, you know, with one of the movies that he just did.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I don't know, but yeah.
But hold on. He knows because he asks him to be there. He does know.
So he asked. Oh, yes. He asked to have that. Okay. And Matthew, I didn't mean to interrupt your interview, but I just, because I knew that you guys were friends. I knew you did a movie together. And River, were you able to stop by and see Matthew at all during his life or no?
In the beginning, it was very painful. But in the beginning, painful for Matthew. But in the beginning, Matthew talked to him. Matthew, that's why Matthew did it. But like, I know he's like, stop talking about me in third person. Matthew, who's in the room, is expressing to me that his addiction, part of that addiction was getting him to get out of his head and get out of his mind to connect. Right. And then he realized he didn't need it to connect.
I know, Matthew, that there's a lot of people who have been crediting you with saving their lives and through the going to AA and helping them get over their addictions. Let me ask you, because we're aware of the fact that people have a higher consciousness while we're here on the planet. So How are you able to affect that kind of change in people? Was it just empathy, compassion, or were you meant to do it?
Just be the change that you want to see with anything, he says. So, hold on. I have the chills. Give me a second. I know. He's laughing at me. He's like, it is kind of cool to talk to me, right? Because I'm like, it's just so weird for me, even as a medium, even with people that knew him. Like, I had no idea that my girlfriend, that Chandler was at his wedding. Like, it was just so, it's not mad. But anyway, he's just like, come on, it's not that bad. Hold on. He's actually referencing our work already. Like, the feelings that, okay, thank you. He had a gift, I feel, I'm getting, of knowing who was in trouble, of knowing who he needed to help. And, he knows Jennifer's really sad. Aniston. And like feeling people that are sad about his passing, he was able to feel what people were going through, why he was here. And that's why I think he was so helpful with other people, because not only did he go through it, but he was also, he can figure out, like, he wanted all his friends to be saved.
Let me ask you a question I think that might help people, which is, now that you're on the flip side, are you aware of previous lifetimes that you've had, if any?
He says yes, but it's too long of a list to go through.
No, and I don't want you to go through it, but the point is, yeah, you're aware of previous lifetimes you've had, and when people get back home, they too become aware of previous lifetimes they've had and previous connections with different people.
Yes.
And so at some point, if you could talk about friends, I know, people are missing you and talking about you because of the show. And maybe if you could just talk about that experience. I mean, I know, as River knows, as Jennifer knows, it's makeup and hair and a set and dialogue and all that stuff.
Best experience of his life. It created the best, with a few minor fights, he's saying, but it created the best group of friends. And I really couldn't have, other than being all the toxicity, he said, I really did have the best life. I couldn't have asked for anything more. Because I wish my brain would have worked a little bit differently, but then I don't.
Because it's all part of the experience. It's all part of the play.
It's what he signed up for.
What he signed up for. And if you could access that just for a moment, in terms of signing up for this kind of a journey, did you sign up for all of it or just parts of it, or what parts of it were?
I wasn't aware of any of it, but
obviously, yeah, but
yeah, but hold on. He signed up for being a martyr, a victim, a creator, a romantic, hopeless. Hold on. Lover of animals, lover of all kinds of all walks of life. A teacher that came much later. And just someone that had to come to terms with his own coloring, he says. So I don't know what he means by that, but.
Let's ask him. What do you mean by your own coloring?
Just, he's making fun of my dress being colorful, but.
If I may, like a painter adding paint to a canvas, because every lifetime is a different color and a different paint. Okay, you're tapping your nose. That means I'm on the money. In a session that I did with hypnosis, my guide was saying, Rich and I looked at a big white canvas and we said, what's the paint? Where's it going to go? And after each lifetime, you step back and look at it and go, I need a little bit more red over here. I need more blue. I need more peace. I need more love. I need more whatever. And so are you talking about the coloring of all your lifetimes or the coloring of just this lifetime, or is it all the same?
This lifetime was pretty effing colorful.
Is there any messages you want to? I listen, Hank Azaria.
Go ahead. Need a lot more color. He goes, He's like, thank you. I think I kind of mastered all the colors. He said.
Do you want to say anything to Hank Azaria, who came out and very eloquently talked about your saving his life? And any messages for Hank? Hank has shown up in our podcast before. He doesn't even know it, but
Hank, and Hank's alive.
Hank's alive. He's a care. You know, he plays Apu in The Simpsons, and he was a very.
Oh. So he's saying that Hank did it himself. I was just an example of what you could do.
Okay. Very good. And he said
that, Hank's got this. He's going to live to be like 102.
So if let's two things, somebody tuning into this podcast is going to be saying these people are trying to profit off. I don't know how we're doing that, but profit off the death of a celebrity. What do you have to say to those people?
I'm a person too. And I mean, the messages that I've given out about him was actually my pro bono work. It wasn't like I was working on a case and he came through. Oh, so wow. It's not like I was getting paid to have someone talk to him or to.
Right.
He goes, I bombarded her during a discussion. And then I was like, wait a second. I had no idea that this person's son knew him.
Yeah.
Right?
Thank you. That totally answers my question. Absolutely, irrevocably. The second part of it is, what do you want to tell people who are suffering right now that need to help with addictions, whether it's alcohol or drugs? What can they do to change that or turn it around?
He's so funny still. He's like, don't go to, he goes, use the buddy system for the jacuzzi, sober or not. Because I did ask him a question. I said, hey, could you have been saved? And he goes, well, we'll never know.
We wouldn't be having this conversation. I think you had an assistant who was there with you, and he had gone out to, I don't know, he picked up something or.
Yeah, so I don't know. That's
any message you want to give to that person who must be feeling a little bit awful about leaving you to fall asleep in a jacuzzi?
Yeah, that's not how I died. He died before he hit the water. That's really what it feels like. It wasn't like that was the after effect. But
so your heart stopped and you checked out of the planet. You left your body and the body slipped into the water.
And it's like he's so funny. He jumped out. He's like, no.
Wow.
Not this.
Not this way. But, you know, we had a conversation with Bob Saget about that, the great comedian who accidentally bumped his head on a ridiculous.
That's Bob. So it was Bob, not
Jerry. Oh, not Gary Shandling. Okay, so Bob Saget was somebody who bumped his head. Hey, they might have known each other.
I don't know. Of course, he says, of course we did. We do.
Okay.
Yeah.
Anything Bob Saget wants to say? We've talked to him after he crossed over.
He's pushing. He's like, now he won the award for the dumbest.
I'm sorry to laugh. Listen, but when Jennifer and I talk to people on the flip side a lot, you've got to laugh at certain the way we leave the stage. Some people trip and fall off the stage. That's just what happens. You know, other people linger forever. They're there on the side of the stage for a long time.
He keeps showing me, you know, Jennifer Aniston. He shows me Jason Bateman. I'm sure he had a lot of influence over Jason Bateman.
Friends of his.
Yeah. And Courtney Cox. Like the love is so real between all of them.
Is there something that you can do or say to them? I mean, on your own, is there a way you can sneak by their house or enter their dreams or tap on their shoulder? What would you do?
He says he's not going to do it just yet because he loves all the stories they're telling
him. Well, yeah.
He gives him the thoughts, though, to talk about. He goes, I keep dumping. That's so great. Aw. He keeps dumping, like, funny thoughts. So, like, you know, at least his death, it was tragic because he's gone, but it wasn't tragic the way he died, he's saying. You know, at least eventually, hopefully the nostalgia, he showed me my dad, hopefully the nostalgia will take place. and we'll be better.
And for those trying to figure what he means, Jennifer's father came through and said, when you can move grief to nostalgia, you begin the healing process, because nostalgia is funny things and sad things, whereas grief is just sad things. And if you can move grief to nostalgia, you begin the healing process. So nostalgia for, and the LA Times wrote an article, or New York Times, I think, might have said that your take on that character, what, for sarcasm and the way you delivered lines, they ever actually went through like so many different lines you'd give, and to say that you changed the way that people view sarcasm, you know, yeah, the snarkasm or whatever, the however you want to call it. Of course, you know, you have screenwriters, you have writers, you have, you know, people put the show together.
But the delivery, that was me.
That was you. It was all you. What about family members? I don't really know that much, but are there, you have family members over here that you want to give a shout out to, or?
You know, I love them. They're in for a lot of craziness. He says he's talked to them. His biggest thing of letting people know he didn't suffer.
So yeah, because of course people just associate that you passed away must be related to your recovery, but you know, apparently it's not. It's just your body didn't quite recover, let's say. And maybe this was the year that you were to check out. Go ahead.
It's like I was just getting my body back. Like just getting everything, you know, back in shape. Back in order. But hold on. He's very grateful he left a book for everyone.
Oh, okay.
Hit me over the head with it.
Jennifer, you haven't seen the book, have you? No, probably not. No. And I haven't. I just happened to catch a you know, something about it.
An interview that they did, like one of the late night people.
Things said. Talked about it. Well, that would be something for everybody tuning in. If you really want to hear what Matthew has to say about his life and his journey, it's in the book.
Yes, right? But he's also saying, you know, today is, every day should be the day of the dead. Have fun, honor them with your snarkiness, if there's anybody that wants to be snarky. And love. He's like, love well.
Love well. River, do you have anything you want to say?
Which means you have to love yourself in order to love others.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. Love well, and you have to love yourself in order to love others. Very important.
Yeah.
I just didn't want to leave River without asking him, do you have any final words you'd like to impart to people missing you?
I'll be back.
And what do you mean by that?
He says he already is. Oh, that's so funny. Hold on. Yeah, there's somebody out there surfing that's like him.
Okay. Because people,
so I just saw somebody, you know, when we talked about who was, you know, the other person that we, what is his
James
name?
James Dean. We did have the experience of talking to James Dean and asking him when he's going to come back, and he told us who he is. And we happen to know who that person is, and we interviewed him and whatever, but all off camera, because he's not interested in letting people know that he's back. Let's just put it that way. Living a happy life. And Bob Saget, we'll give you one last thought. Do you have something you want to say?
It's so funny because he's like, he wins for the dumbest reentry, like going back to home. He's just so happy about that, but hold on. Laughter is great medicine.
Laughter is such great medicine. And it was funny because I asked him for the punchline for a joke that Jennifer did not know the punchline. And it had to do with his stand-up, when he would talk about a dog who was, you know, doing some weird act. And he gave it to Jennifer and she said, I'm not saying that. It was a typical Bob Saget response. All right. Luana, is there anything else you want to bring to the fore? I know I only got Jennifer for a few minutes left.
Oh, actually I'm running late.
You're running late. Okay. Well, let's thank everybody. Matthew, thank you for showing up. I really,
is her picture still on your fridge?
Who, Luana?
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah. I'm looking at her right now, actually.
Oh, she says it's crooked.
It is. It is. Okay. Oh, is that better? You happy now? Okay. Luana, it's not crooked if you're always in my heart. All right. Very good, Lou. Thank you for showing up on the Day of the Dead. Thank you, Matthew Perry. I was kind of afraid he might show up, but I wasn't going to ask.
I didn't ask.
But you know,
and then I asked Luana. I said, Luana, is there, you know, and again, it goes back to, we're not profiting off. This is not, there was actually people who knew him, who are friends that I've talked to, that we're not making anything off of that.
No. And the whole point is we're
trying. And I didn't go and try to find him. He found me. It wasn't.
Yeah, I know. And that's why I'm mentioning it. Cause when we asked the same questions to everybody, you know, who greeted you. And I figured that River would have shown up because you guys were close pals.
I did not know they were close pals, by the way.
So, yeah, it's a lovely thing to learn. Anyway, we love you, Jennifer. Thank you for your gifts. We really appreciate it. And Matthew, River, and Bob, and Luana, thanks, guys, for showing up on our podcast. Love you. This has been Hacking the Afterlife Podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. For more information, jennifershaffer.com, martinizone.com, or richmartini.com. Hacking the Afterlife documentary is available on gaia.com via Amazon Prime.